There's many ways you can and will and have shape your waterfront, and this conference is all about giving you tools, giving you information to help you do that better in the future. I'd like to just then note the fact that we are on a boat, but this boat is also in a park. It's in the Hudson, beautiful Hudson River Park. I don't know if Madeline Wills is here yet, but we want to thank her for hosting this year after year. And I'd like to now to ask Cameron Clark of Hornblower Cruisers. This is, often half-jokingly say, we're a conference like a lot of other conferences, but we are a conference on a boat, our distinction. But it's a remarkable, wonderful thing to do, to have this on the boat, to have a facility like this, but also then to debark and walk around the harbor a little bit on this boat. It's an amazing, amazing thing. So a warm welcome for our host, Cameron Clark of Hornblower Cruisers. Cameron, where are you? Right there.
Well, thanks so very much, Roland. First and foremost, I just want to thank some of our crew and team members. After a busy night last night of events, they were here getting the boats turned back over, ready this morning for you all here. Also just want to say a quick thanks to some of our statue cruises brethren, Mike Burke in the back, James Selecchia, Hal Clancy, to name a few, who are here with us. And really, as we were talking earlier, Roland, out front, it's really an exciting time to be a part of the waterfront community. The great work here, part of one of our docking locations in Hudson River Park, Pier 15, EDC, the great work that they're doing there. And year after year, since the Hornblower family of companies have come here, we've seen continued growth, continued expansion in the areas in which we work and live, and is where you are today, even a place where you can play here on the water. And it really is an exciting to be a part of that expansion and the great growth here within this city. Statue Cruises had its best year ever. Since 2008, since we've been here, and it's really showing that people wanting to get down to the water, wanting to be a part of the parks and access to the waterfront, and we're just excited to support MWA and be a part of that process. So thank you all. Have a wonderful day. Thanks for bringing the beautiful weather rolling, and everybody enjoy yourselves.
Cameron, thank you, Terry. Well, I'm not going to ask you to look at the program now, but sometime in the program, look at the program. You'll see there are many wonderful sponsors. Folks go to conferences, you know, these conferences sometimes cost $500, $800, $1,000. You not-for-profit folks in the audience and government folks in the audience know how much you paid for this. It was the price of a bad movie and stale popcorn at your local theater. And we want to keep it that way. And the way we are able to keep it that way, we want it that way because we want everybody at this conference. We want this thing be a people's conference, open to everybody. And the way we do that is having generous, generous sponsors. Please take a look at all of them. Many of them here are at tables. You can hear about the work they do, their interest in the waterfront. And actually, when before I introduced the premier sponsor, I didn't mention the most important thing that at any MWA event, and particularly at the conference, your job before you leave this boat is to find two people you do not know, find out why they care about the waterfront, what they're doing on the waterfront, and get to know them and understand this larger network that we're all part of. But before we start, this conference does have a premier sponsor. It's an amazing organization, ARCADIS, doing work around the world on sustainability and resilience. And we're happy to have Peter Gluss here to say a couple of welcoming words on behalf of ARCADIS. Big warm for Peter Gluss. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rollins. We really appreciate having the opportunity to sponsor this event, and we thank you all for coming out. You know, you join the community of people who are focused on resiliency and sustainability and adaption in New York. So Roland told me to be very brief and focused, so I will. You know, I was traveling for the past couple of weeks meeting some colleagues from Singapore and Sydney, Australia, and the UK and Europe. And I felt like when I was in conversations with them that I had stepped back a couple of years. I felt like I was sort of, it reminded me of the conversations we were having in New York in 2013. And you know, I reflected on that, and I reflected on how we in New York have really stood on the shoulders of the people in the cities around the world who struggle with sustainability and resiliency and adaptive problems. And you know, we benefit from that in a tremendous way, and with that comes responsibility, of course. And I thought about how we came to that place so quickly. And I wanted to just sort of throw three things out there at you. The first one was, I think there's been tremendous leadership shown by Mayor de Blasio and Dan Zirilli and ORR, and the folks in his staff who have pushed forward 200 to 300 projects, a very complex capital program that really tries to solve unprecedented design and permitting challenges. I also think that there has been an extremely efficient transfer of knowledge globally between the cities of this world and New York. You know, New York is a melting pot. We take the best of wherever, we bring it together, we mix it up and we blend it, and that's true for our culture, but it's also true for our thought about resiliency and sustainability and adaptability. And I think the last thing that I think is very unique about New York is we have a very interesting sort of funding challenge. We have some projects that are really heavily funded, and we have some projects that are not funded at all. And so I think there's this tension between the sufficient projects that have probable funding and great projects that have partial funding. And I think we live in that tension, and out of that tension comes creativity and innovation, and that's what drives us forward here in New York. So I hope you all debate that tension, and welcome again to the Hornblower. And Roland, I'll pass it back to you.
Thank you, Peter. Great introduction. My name is Chris Ward. I have the pleasure of being the chairman of MWA, and it's great to see so many of you here again. Since it's such a beautiful day, I'm actually going to start off with a joke. And it's about seeing familiar faces and knowing people well, and there are so many of you who have been with MWA and who fought hard for our waterfront. So it's a British joke, so I'll do a little bit of translation. So this guy walks into a pub and he's completely pissed, which in England means he's drunk. And he's sort of reeling around, and the proprietor, which the pub's proprietor, goes up to him and says, "Excuse me, sir, you're completely pissed, intoxicated, and we're not going to serve you. You have to leave immediately." So the man sort of looks at him and walks out of the pub. 5 minutes later, the same guy comes back into the pub, completely intoxicated still. And now the owner's like really pretty mad. And he goes, "Look, I told you before, out with you, just out with you right now. I'm not having this type of drunkenness in my pub. Out you go, sir." So the man once again sort of turns around and walks out of the pub. Not 5 minutes later, he comes back in again. And now the owner is completely furious. And he goes, "That's it. Out with you, man. You're going out the door right now." And the guy turns around and looks at him and he says, "My God, man, how many pubs do you work at?" So like many of you, my God, man, how many Metropolitan Waterfront Alliances conferences are you willing to show up to? But again, thank you for coming. This is really going to be a glorious day. We have some key leaders. I'll be moderating a panel with the great Congressman Nadler, perhaps one of the leading voices on the waterfront of New York, and it's great to have Congressman Nadler today. Scott Stringer, who I will introduce in a minute, is here with us today. But let me just characterize a little bit about where MWA is today, because we're changing. There's been a long, hard road that we've worked with all of you on. I think we've made tremendous strides. Mayor de Blasio's five-borough ferry initiative is without a doubt one of the capstones of a lot of hard work by all of you. But we've also expanded our base. We've created a sense of the harbor, which has gone beyond the dedicated few, those of you who toiled long and hard here. You know, and I think back to Hudson River Park, Pier 40. But we have grown as an organization, and we've changed as an organization, and we've actually embraced a much larger community than we probably thought possible, and that we would think that people would want to become part of MWA. So with that, MWA has launched what we believe is really a transformative undertaking, and that is the rebranding of MWA. So we will no longer be, henceforth, the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance. We will simply be the Waterfront Alliance. And so with that, I'm going to unfurl the new Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance logo with my distinguished board members and colleagues, and you will see now, ta-da! And now, and let me just say for a minute, this is not new Coke. We are sticking with this brand. And the reason why is, in some respects, Metropolitan, as much as we all think we live in a metropolitan city, not everybody in this region is, I think, again, particularly looking across to New Jersey, defines themselves in a metropolitan area. And we thought it was very important to capture the full vision of what the Waterfront Alliance will be going forward. So the logo and the title are really a reference to the verticality of a city, of where we all live and work, and where the city meets the water. And we think this is a way of taking the Waterfront Alliance into the next decade of leadership. So look for hats, look for banners, look for that logo. We'll be around. So And now it's really my great privilege to introduce someone you all know. That's not new Coke. We're not revoking it. It's going to stay there. It's now my privilege to introduce somebody you all know all the way back to his incredible days as Manhattan Borough President, leading again a vision for the Manhattan waterfront, taking plans, taking stands, providing leadership to people who need leadership and need the ability to see the politics of a particular situation and transform it. And from there, he's now been elected and is serving as Comptroller of the City of New York. He has been a dear, dear friend to MWA, and he's been a dear, dear friend to me in my brief life at the Port Authority and at DEP, and it's my great privilege to introduce Scott Stringer, the Comptroller of the City of New York. And he's wearing a tie.
So I'm really glad to be here and talk about, you know, talking points. So I wanted to thank the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance, but no more, right? So we take Metropolitan out, and now it's Waterfront Alliance. So it's really great to be here with all of you. This is a huge crowd. And I know that all of you are thinking about someone who can't be with us this morning, a man who I was privileged to present with a Hero of the Harbor Award just last year, and that's Captain John Doswell. And I think that on a beautiful day like this, when I was borough president, I love the time that we would take seniors out into the water and enjoy a very special day. And Captain Doswell was always excited to do that. And I just want to remember him as a dedicated public servant and a tremendous New Yorker. And his contribution to rejuvenation of our waterfront will continue to inspire us for generations to come. And one thing for sure, John would think that this is the coolest venue for a conference of this kind, right? Right here where he belonged on the waterfront. And I'm guessing that many of you came here by bus and train, and maybe one or two of you took a car. But we all know the importance of these transit systems to our city. But there's another means of transportation that was here long before the subway. And if we just look around us, water literally surrounds us. And the city has always had this connective tissue for centuries. 201 years ago, the first steamboat ferry service began operating between Manhattan and Brooklyn. Robert Fulton's ferries took less than 12 minutes to make the commute. Think about that. We've come a long way since then, and I'm pleased that after years of neglect, New York has rediscovered the value of our waterways. And this conference with all of you here today is proof of that. New York's waterways are the cleanest they've been in a century. And that's because we're finally investing in infrastructure projects that protect our environment and bring people to the waterfront. And these investments are reducing sewage overflows by expanding capacity. They're also restoring the waterfront's natural habitat, including wetlands and salt marshes. The bottom line is that we're transforming the way we think about our waterfront from the Staten Island Blue Belt in Jamaica Bay to Orchard Beach and Governor's Island. Your conference will focus on many of these issues, from the five-borough waterway transit plan to greater public access and plans for increased resiliency. Now, these have been my priorities as well. In 2013, when I was still borough president, our office designed an award-winning plan that opens up the East River waterfront to more public use while beginning the process of protecting it against future storm damage. We worked very collaboratively with the local community board, a community-based planning process, Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh, and other East Side elected officials. We called it the East River Blueway, and the blueprint was developed in consultation with so many people. And I'm proud that the city and state have adopted many of our recommendations as part of the East River Resiliency Project and Sandy recovery efforts. And after all, what happened when Sandy devastated the city, let's face it, it cost $20 billion in damages and claimed 44 lives. We must never be caught unprepared again. To help ensure this, our office has now proposed as controller that New York City launch an innovative green bonds program. The goal is to fund environmentally friendly projects with bonds that will green our streets and waterfronts, cut our carbon footprint, deliver clean water, and build a more livable city. Green bonds could fund projects directly related to waterways, such as construction of new ferry terminals. It's an idea whose time has come, and I'm urging the city to step up and play a national leadership role in this effort. We've got to build on your hard work and ensure that our waterways continue to offer new possibilities for transportation, growth, and access. And we have to become magnets for recreation and commerce. They go hand in hand. So I want to thank all of you for thinking about the long-term impact of our economy. All of you recognize that the kind of urban-based planning, community-based planning is so necessary when we talk about building infrastructure projects, affordable housing, or just opening our waterfront. It takes everybody to do this. No government entity, no matter how powerful, can go it alone, nor should they. It has to be with all of us in the room collaborating. And that takes a lot of hard work, and there's powerful interests that sometimes get in the way. But the people in this room, in this organization, under this new leadership, this powerful leadership, I believe will make a fundamental difference and change the course of how we view our waterfront and our land use process. So I just wanted to come by today and let you know that the panelists and the people who will participate will begin a serious blueprint for our waterways. And for that, I thank you. And I know if John was here today, he would just be absolutely ready to roll today. So we got to do this in his memory. Thank you all very, very much. It's great to be here. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Julie Pullen. I'm very proud to be a member of the board of the Waterfront Alliance. I'm also on the faculty at Stevens Institute of Technology, which is in Hoboken, New Jersey, on the beautiful New Jersey waterfront. I'm both an oceanographer and a meteorologist, and I lead a Department of Homeland Security-funded Center of Excellence on Maritime Security. I'm very pleased this morning to be introducing our keynote speaker, Timothy Beatley. Timothy Beatley is the Teresa Heinz Professor of Sustainable Communities in the Department of Urban and Environmental Planning of the School of Architecture at the University of Virginia. Much of his work has focused on the subject of sustainable communities and creative strategies by which cities and towns can fundamentally reduce their ecological footprints while at the same time becoming more livable and equitable places. Professor Beatley is the author or co-author of more than 15 books on these subjects, including Green Urbanism, as well as one entitled Planning for Coastal Resilience. His latest book, Blue Urbanism, Exploring Connections Between Cities and Oceans, it has recently come out and is available upstairs on the back deck after his conversations. He will be there. After his remarks, he'll be signing copies of his book. He has a really, really phenomenal background on all of these topics, including engagement on a documentary film about green cities and urban nature entitled The Nature of Cities, which was shown on PBS. He writes a regular column for Planning Magazine called Evergreen about environmental and sustainability matters. He has his Ph.D. in city and regional planning from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, as well as a master's in political science and a master's in urban planning from the University of Oregon. We welcome Professor Beatley.
Well, it's great to be here, and it really is a cool venue. And I don't think I've ever spoken on a boat like this before. Anyway, it is terrific to be here with so many of you working hard on marine issues and really dedicated to that. It's great to hear all the things going on in New York. It seems to me that New York really is becoming an aqua-centric city. And maybe we'll have a chance to talk about that a little bit. So I'm a little bit out of my element. Oh, there is a slide. This is my one slide, I guess. Roland told me I wasn't really permitted to show slides. And then you have a slide projector. This is my normal. I know you can't. We can't really show slides. So I'm a little bit out of my element today. But so I have more of a speech, more of a talk than I'm probably used to giving. But I want, in the short time that I have with you, to talk about two main ideas. One of them is this concept that we call biophilic cities. And the second one is this notion of blue urbanism, which is what this newest book is about. So let me just say a few words about this concept of biophilia and biophilic cities, because I think New York is becoming a biophilic city, in large part because of its water. So I have to give a lot of credit to E.O. Wilson, Ed Wilson at Harvard, who popularized this concept of biophilia. And he defines it as the innately emotional affiliation of human beings to other living organisms. Innate means hereditary and hence part of ultimate human nature. So it's an acknowledgement of the profound connection and need that we have for nature, for contact with nature. We carry with us our ancient brains, and we're happiest and healthiest when we have nature nearby. So we really need nature. It's not something optional. It's absolutely essential for a healthy and meaningful life. But as we increasingly live in cities, we need to be more creative about how to restore and regrow that nature, and thus the concept of biophilic cities. So biophilic cities, a lot of what we have been working on is trying to think about what is a biophilic city. Well, it's clearly a natureful city. It's a city with abundant nature. It's cities that place nature at the center of their design and planning, that work hard to foster connections with that natural world. Our vision of biophilic cities is cities where residents are actually immersed in nature, surrounded by nature. Nature is not just something that you walk to. It's not just the park down the road. We think we need to really reimagine cities so that it's the concept of living in the park, perhaps, living in the garden, living in the forest. And in fact, one of our partner cities in our biophilic cities project, Singapore, has not long ago changed their urban motto. So they used to call themselves Singapore, a garden city, and now it's Singapore, a city in a garden. That sounds like a small change, but it's quite profound. So we want to promote this idea, this experience of living in a city, that experience, that urban experience, can be a natureful experience. And it's a beautiful day, a lovely day. I've arrived last night from Virginia. It's a beautiful time of the year, of course. It's one of my favorite times. Spring, you hear this remarkable chorus of nature, right, in my part of the world, beginning to hear tree frogs and crickets and katydids and at the end of the evening, and lots of birds, of course. And so one of my favorite sounds this time of year, at the end of the evening, especially into the day, wood thrushes. It's beautiful melody, this sort of beautiful soothing sounds of birds. Well, we know, actually, we understand that birds and birdsong have tremendous biophilic power. There are even hospitals now in the UK that are piping in these sounds to reduce the stress for children about to be given shots or about to go into surgery. And by the way, there's a new study by John Marsloff from the University of Washington showing a positive correlation between birdsong, presence of birds in birdsongs, and property values. Perhaps not a big value, not a big surprise. So one of the things we've been proposing is maybe we ought to be judging the progress of cities in different ways. And maybe we judge the progress of a city by the number of residents or the number of neighborhoods that have abundant birdsong. Birdsong is a measure of urban progress. So nature has this remarkable power to calm, to soothe, to restore. The Japanese refer to these effects as shinrin-yoku. The English translation is forest bathing. And there's a growing body of evidence that shows that a walk in a forest, a walk through nature, has the result of reducing stress hormone levels, boosts our immune system. And the Japanese are so convinced about this that they've set up a series of forest bathing therapy stations in cities around the country. Interesting idea, forest bathing, you know, that you're walking through a forest and the dappled light, the sounds of birds, that, you know, no wonder that we are calmed and soothed and feel better and are often happier and more productive. So nature is a special antidote, a magical elixir in responding to long-term chronic stresses. And the evidence is mounting that we are more creative in the presence of nature. Some studies that have come out of psychology that show now that in the presence of nature, we're more likely to be generous. Interesting. Studies from economics that show we're more likely to think longer term in the presence of nature. So if we're thinking about long-term resilience and sustainability, we need nature. Nature has to be everywhere around us. So my team at UVA, University of Virginia, has been trying to support the biophilic cities movement in a number of ways. In the fall of 2013, we launched a global network of biophilic cities, starting with 10 partner cities. The idea is really gaining traction, I'm happy to say. Last April, about a year ago, we participated in a series of events in Birmingham in the UK. We witnessed a very public pronouncement there that they intended to be the first biophilic city in the UK. Just last month in Washington, D.C., the D.C. City Council adopted a biophilic cities resolution.
And also just last month, we organized an event in Philadelphia around biophilic cities. There's an early effort in that city, a nascent group calling themselves Biophilly. So we're seeing similar things happen in other cities around the country and around the world. And interestingly enough, Twitter traffic is telling as well. Last week, I saw a tweet that read, "Sustainable cities are so yesterday. Make room for biophilic cities." Okay, it was a friend of our network. Yeah, definitely. But nevertheless, so I encourage you to take a look. We have a webpage, biophiliccities.org. Add your name to our e-newsletter list. Help us grow this global network. Many of them are coastal cities. We're just about to unveil a new webpage and a new protocol that lays out expectations and guidelines for new cities joining the global network. And it would be great, by the way, to have New York City in the global network. So one of the ideas that we've been exploring is whether there is some sort of minimum daily requirement of nature. I'm not sure, I think there is. I'm not sure what it is, but it's an interesting idea to think about. We also are often talking about this concept of the urban nature diet and what makes up a nutritious urban nature diet in terms of physically and emotionally. It's fun to think about that. What even constitutes a serving of urban nature? Is it hearing that bird that I mentioned? Is it seeing two birds and four trees? Two birds, four trees, an urban forest, a green roof? Two green roofs, a green wall, and five? I don't know. Some combination. I'm being silly. But it's a really important thing to think about in a city. And water plays, of course, a big a part of that. So part of my the joy of my job is that I do hear about things going around the world. I'm often receiving emails, and there's an awful lot going on, lots of creative design and planning and work about how to integrate nature into dense cities. Some of my favorites include the Spanish designer and activist, a guy named Mark Granion, who's devised a lightweight system for fitting green rooftops on the tops of municipal buses. Interesting idea. So there are a couple of cities now in Spain that have buses that are moving around the city with green rooftops. Or the New Zealand company that's been designing and installing hanging vertical gardens. Just last week, they sent me an email showing me they're quite excited because a new hanging garden installation just next to the Wellington Opera House is showing the presence of birds, nesting birds. Or the tremendous and creative flood of new urban buildings designed around biophilic principles. One of my favorites is the Ferrer Building. Hasn't been built yet, but Ferrer Building in Barcelona, designed by our former dean, actually, William McDonough. Its most impressive feature is the inclusion in the lobby of a butterfly hatchery. The two walls in the lobby contain glass shells with butterfly chrysalises. And as Bill says, "So, as you go to your office, your decor is hatching butterflies." Interesting. Another of my favorites locally here in New York is the Cook Fox-designed Lafayette Building on the site of a former Soho gas station that will have 11,000 square feet of window boxes and balconies with plants native to Manhattan. So part of the challenge, though, is in seeing the remarkable amount of nature that's already around us. And I'm a big advocate for what I call cities of awe, that we need to be conscious of the nature around us, and a lot of it is water-related, and celebrate that awe. The many small elements of awe, but the larger elements as well. Opportunities to tie into wonder, amazement, fascination. And there are many potential moments of awe in cities, and we need to be ready to seize them and enjoy them. And we know that there is a remarkable biodiversity, of course, in cities like New York. We've gotten to know, for example, Amy Savage, who has done all this amazing work surveying ant density on the median strips of Broadway here in New York. And she's discovered more than 42 species of ants, two species that they didn't know existed. Quite remarkable. Or in many cities, the remarkable marine life close to shore's edge. In Wellington, New Zealand, one of our partner cities, they regularly see orcas in their harbor, and that event brings amazing numbers of people immediately rushing to the shore to watch. But even when we have lots of nature and wildness around us, I'm afraid we're often oblivious to it. So I think we need to be thinking about what my friend Mark Beckoff calls rewilding our hearts. And he has a book by that title, by the way. Just as we rewild cities through biophilic design and biophilic planning, we must undergo a similar shift in our mindset and thinking, to be open to seeing the nature around us, to caring about it, and to be interested in learning about it. Beckoff says, rewilding our hearts is about becoming re-enchanted with nature. It's about nurturing our sense of wonder. I summarize Beckoff's ideas in terms of the four C's: compassion, connection, curiosity, and coexistence. So this brings me to the second and quite related concept that I want to talk about, and that's blue urbanism. And by blue urbanism, I mean all of those ways that we can connect the urban realm with the marine and the aquatic realm. And this really, for me, grew out of my perception of the massive disconnect that exists, at least in city planning, urban planning, between cities and water, and oceans especially. So we live on the blue planet, as Sylvia Earle and many others have reminded us. More than 70%, of course, of our land area is land surface is water. We also live on the urban planet, increasingly urban planet. But in my world, the city, the urban part and the ocean part don't often meet. But they have to, right? And we've got to start thinking about this and changing our language and talking, using words like blue urbanism, I would argue. So at the heart of my argument, the arguments in the book, are a couple of key assumptions. First, we need and want to be near water. It provides significant emotional and other benefits for us. This is not a radical idea or a big surprise to you all who live here. But the evidence about this and the evidence of the biophilia of water is growing, and that's really interesting. Several recent studies by Michael DePledge and his team at the University of Exeter in the UK show the power of proximity to water. In one large study, self-reported health increased with proximity to the coast. In another series of studies, participants were shown and asked to react to a series of photographs, some containing water. As predicted, DePledge's team concludes, both natural and built scenes containing water were associated with higher preferences, greater positive affect, and higher perceived restorativeness than those without water. My friend Jay Nichols, who's recently written this terrific book, Blue Mind, I don't know if you've read that, pulls together a lot of the evidence about the neuroscience and psychology of water, and Jay talks a lot about the emotional services provided by water. So water is very biophilic, it is clear. One of the most important aspects of biophilia is these concepts called prospect and refuge, something we innately seek in environments. When we think about how we tend to organize our communities, our homes, our businesses around water, it's very much a response to prospect and refuge. And there are kind of two parts to this. The prospect is the preference for wide, expansive panoramic views. Not surprising, perhaps given the survival benefits imparted by such a sensibility. The second is refuge. We feel safer in spaces where we're protected, nested, where our backs are covered and our presence somewhat hidden. How we position and orient towards water usually responds to both of these biophilic impulses, prospect and refuge. So we have a tremendous opportunity, it seems to me, in living near water to take advantage of the life-enhancing quality of life benefits and of our deep-seated biophilic urges and desires and pleasures of being near water and to shorelines and to oceans. This, we know, must be balanced by an equal concern for the dangers of climate change and sea level rise, but I like to spin the challenge in a positive way and acknowledge the profound life-enhancing beneficial dimensions of proximity to water. So this is a message that is not lost on you all and not lost on many coastal cities, and one can tick off a number of things, a number of stories told in the book. Places like San Francisco working on their blue greenway, connecting parks and spaces along a 13-mile stretch of its southeastern waterfront, part of a larger 500-mile region-wide bay trail. Baltimore's Inner Harbor, where a new master plan envisions a continuous pedestrian trail around it, or Boston's Harborway, and the new buildings like the Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital That are emphasizing physical and visual connections with the water as a as an element of therapy. And so lots happening. A second premise of blue urbanism is that cities and the urbanites who occupy them can and must show leadership in the marine realm. Cities have the resources, the wherewithal, the potential to make a huge difference. Blue urbanism, moreover, holds that cities must develop deeper emotional connections to the marine environment and the organisms and life found there. Part of the challenge may be for us to forge new emotional bonds, rewilding our marine hearts, if you will, to put it in Mark Beckoff's terminology. This is already happening in many coastal environments, and more building of emotional connections will be needed. But there are many creative examples happening around the U.S. and around the world. Among them, 150,000 oysters being raised in the inner harbor of Baltimore by schools and corporate sponsors. The impressive core of beach naturalists in Seattle, actually in other cities as well, that help visitors to understand the amazing marine life that they see during periods of low tide, or the school kids who participate in the Georgia Strait Alliance's Drift Card program in Vancouver, a creative effort to engage the public in understanding what the impacts of an oil spill might be, or in our partner city, Wellington, New Zealand, where they've been working hard on the concept of blue belts as a complement to their extensive green belts and their more terrestrial land conservation strategies. So I'm needing to close and have more that I could say, but the agenda is rather expansive, I would say. Lots for us to do, lots of creative ideas. We need to rethink the way we source seafood. We need to promote things like community-supported fisheries. We need to kind of reimagine the nature of cities themselves, rethink the spaces. You're doing that very well in this city. I often show a slide of San Francisco, not to pick on San Francisco, but their urban spaces map, you know, beyond the shore's edge. It's gray or black or white typically in maps, sending the message that there's nothing there. We've got to kind of reimagine cities to include that nature all around us. So. And I want you all to think, as you are, pretty boldly about how we can reconnect to that marine environment, and maybe even the spaces, the organisms and habitats that are not so close. So one of the ideas in the book is this concept of ocean sister cities. Just as we have, typically in any city, a number of conventional sister cities around the world, could we imagine ocean sister cities? So a city adopting a seamount, a hydrothermal vent, an underwater rift, and adding that to the list of ocean of sister cities. So we have a lot that we could do, a lot going on, and I think I'll just thank you for entertaining a few thoughts about cities and oceans, and I'll stop there. Do we have any time for questions at this point?
Actually, not.
No.
Please.
I had the pleasure of reading Tim's book on a flight back and forth to Seattle for the planning conference. It is a great read, a great book, really mind-opening. And Tim will be here at least for another hour or so. We're running a little behind, so I'm afraid we can't do Q&A right now. To autograph this book, if those of you are smart enough and have a few extra shekels to go buy it. I encourage you to do that. Really a wonderful book. And so another warm applause for our keynote. Thank you very much, Tim. In the interest of time, I'm going to invite our plenary panel up while I do a couple of things. And so if I can take your positions, Joan and everybody else, and I know we have a camera crew here. I want to recognize a few folks that you'll be hearing us, Congressman Nadler, Council Members Menchaca and Rodriguez. We have staff members from Assembly Member Kavanaugh, Council Members Richards, Vallone, Williams, Levine, and Reynoso are here, and also staff member for Native Alaska's Dan Wiley is here. But before we start, if I could ask, just for a brief second, a good friend, I think the state senator from the waterfront is here. Dan Squadron, our good friend. If you, I ask you to say a couple of words to the crowd, if you could. Warm welcome for Dan Squadron.
Thank you very much, Roland. And I just asked Roland how big this was 5 years ago, and it was just about 50% as big as it is today, which is a great sign. In my district, I represent more fish than people, and they complain a lot less, so that's another argument. And as the panel comes up, I want to say one thing. I walked in with Gene Rushinoff, and if you look at who's on the panel behind us here, think about this idea. It is not even a question that what's happening with the waterfront is what's happening with mass transit, with the infrastructure of our city, with the future of our city today. That's not on its own. That's because of the work of all of you, the member organizations and the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance. So for that, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. We've come a long way and have a long way to go until we are truly using this extraordinary resource to its maximum potential for the environment, for transportation, for recreation, and for our economy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dan.